13, verses 25 to 33. I'll be reading from the New Revised Standard Version. Please listen to these close to the Lord. At the end of 40 days, they returned from spying out the land. And they came to Moses and Aaron and to all the congregation of Israelites in the wilderness of Paran at Kadesh. They brought back word to them and to all the congregation and showed them the fruit of the land. And they told him, "We came to a land to which you sent us. It flows with milk and honey, and this is its fruit. Yet the people who live in the land are strong, and their towns are fortified and very large. And besides, we saw the descendants of Amalek there. But Amalekites lived in the land of Negev, the Hittites and the Jebusites, and the Amorites lived in the hill country, and the Canaanites lived by the sea and along the Jordan." But Caleb cried to the people before Moses and said, "Let us go up at once and occupy, for we are well able to overcome it." Then the men who had gone up with him said, "We are not able to go up against these people, for they are stronger than we are." So they brought to the Israelites an unfavorable report of the land that they had spied out, saying, "The land that we have gone through as spies is a land that devours its inhabitants. And all the people that we saw in it are of great size. We saw the Nephilim, the Anakites from Benjamin, and to ourselves, we seem like grasshoppers, and so we seem to them." A holy reading for the people of God.
Basic words. I can assure you I'm only going to talk about them twice in my sermon, so buckle up. But first, let's pray. Lord God, we thank you for the opportunity to gather in your presence today. I ask that you be with us all in the coming moments, that we might be able to learn more about who you are and who you have called us to be, what it means to be your people. Speak to us this morning, God. Amen. Fake news. A phrase that might make some of you in this room shudder, a phrase that came about in the 1800s and came back to life in the 2016-17 election era, a phrase that is still talked about to this day, a phrase that I'm going to preach on this morning. But what is fake news, anyways? According to the most scholarly source on the internet, Wikipedia, fake news is simply defined as a presentation of information that is false or misleading, information that is contrary to fact. I know that almost all of you in this room are on Facebook, and you are joining us from Facebook. In fact, you could probably open your Facebook, but you could probably open your Facebook app right now and find a fake headline on your account, something like, 10 reasons why the water you're drinking is making your hair grow smaller, or 5 reasons why 5 cups of coffee a day is somehow good for you. They are headlines that are somewhat intriguing, and they get you to bite, only to give you false information, fake news, that leaves you wondering and wandering the internet for more answers, probably more fake news. But fake news has been around for far longer than the 1800s and far longer than the 1716 election era. We find fake news right here in this word that we call holy. We find fake news right here in our scripture reading for today. If you didn't catch it, our scripture reading for today comes from Numbers 13, 25 through 33. The title of this book might actually sound like fake news enough for you. Book of Numbers. Interestingly enough, our name for this book, here comes the ancient word. Interestingly enough, our name for this book comes from the Greek word arithmoi. It sounds a lot like arithmetic. That's where we get our for arithmetic from. Now, I don't know if I've missed something in my years of theological education and upbringing in the church, or perhaps my reading of the book of Numbers, but I don't think that it has a whole lot to do with arithmetic. And I don't know if it has a whole lot to do with numbers. But I will say that the book of Numbers is centered around two different censuses. Really important. There's one in Numbers 1, where you read a long laundry list of boring names, words. And then you put this in story and you come to Numbers 26 and there's another long laundry list of names. Yes, counting people has to do with numbers. But before we get too far into the words of our exact scripture for today, I want to continue to set it up. If you've been following along with our Bible year reading, congratulations, you have made it out of Leviticus. Round of applause to all of you. And those of you who aren't following along, you missed Leviticus. Anyways, we now find ourselves back into the Israelite narrative, back into the narrative of the Israelites wandering in the wilderness. Directly before our story, there is actually three different rebellions. In Numbers 11, there's a rebellion of the people groaning against God, and it doesn't end well for them. God consumes part of their camp. In Numbers 11, again, there's another complaint from the people of God about the manna that God has provided them from heaven. And then in Numbers chapter 12, we find a rebellion from Moses' very own, Aaron and Miriam. They are jealous. Three rebellions against God and God's leader Moses lead up to our text today. The Israelites, despite their groaning and rebellion in the wilderness, find themselves on the doorstep to the promised land. The land of their ancestors, the land that will allow themselves to be fruitful and multiply more than there are stars in the sky. Their groaning and complaining will be no more. Their days of slavery have come to an end, and they will be able to worship God the Lord all the days of their life. So, God commands Moses to select 12 guys from each of the tribes of Israel and send them on a mission to go and observe this promised land. They're supposed to go to the land and simply take a look at it. See if it's good or bad, see who's there. In my mind, I read the story and I think of it as sort of a formality. God has already promised them the job. Here's the promised land. They get it. So all they have to do is go through the interview process and it's theirs, right? So they go out and they do just that. And honestly, it starts out great. I mean, they come to this place called the Wadi Eshkol and they get some good grapes out of the deal. The story is going well, even to the beginning of our passage today, in Numbers 25. They have now been gone for 40 days. That's an important number, so don't forget it. Then they make their way back to Moses and Aaron and the people who are gathered there. They present the congregation of people with their report. They even bring some fruit from the land as proof that it is good. In fact, in verse 27, the initial report that they give to this congregation of people is that it flows with milk and honey. The land that God talks about at the end of Leviticus is right there. The land that they have been longing for. You might begin to imagine and think of the hope that began to fill the Israelites who were gathered in that moment. They are finally going to make it out of the desert and into the land that they can call their own, because the Lord is a Lord of covenants and the Lord provides. Even when the second part of that report comes, if you remember, they might flinch a little at hearing that the people who live there are great warriors and might be a little bit bigger than them, but they would surely brush it off. Because if you remember that first census in Numbers 1, it tells us that we have over 600,000 capable warriors in the Israelite encampment. This leads Caleb to say, "All right, well, let's go do it." Hope leaves the room when the others begin to speak up. They don't think that it's a good idea. They begin to deny for themselves this promised land. The second part of our scripture reading for today is what the Israelites are actually told. In verse 32, the land is no longer a land that flows with milk and honey, but it's a land that eats, consumes, devours its inhabitants. No longer are the people slightly bigger than them and just great warriors, but they are now Nephilim. These are the half-divine creatures that are talked about in the beginning of Genesis. The Israelites have mythologized the story into something that it never was. The story has become nothing other than a false report, mere gossip, fake news. Funny enough, the Hebrew word that is used here to mark the false report, when used in a verbal form, is actually always used negatively. So look it up. It's used in the prophets to mark the whispers of the people, the wrong whispers of the people. It's used in Proverbs to mark gossip among the people. It's used here to mark fake news. Friends, it seems as though fake news has been around a lot longer than 2016 and a lot longer than the 1800s. It's simply taken on different names as the seasons have changed. But fake news still fills our story and is at its heart. We read the story and wonder where the hope might be. We look to the verses that come immediately after. Things aren't looking so good there either. We find the people rebelling once more. The people disregard the good report that initially comes to them, the report that Joshua and Caleb gave, and they give in to the fake news of the others. We find out in 14:4 that the reason they are buying into this fake news is they still have an eye to Egypt, the desire to go back. They no longer have their eyes on the Lord, but on their own desires and the fake news. And for 40 days they sit spying on the land. 40 years of wilderness wandering ahead of them. We read this story, and we quickly realize how relatable it is to us. Some of us are so close to getting it right. We have followed the pillar of smoke. We have followed the pillar of fire. We get to the edge of the promised land, and we bite into the norms of society. We read articles on Facebook. We watch endless videos of other people's lives on TikTok and Instagram. We doom scroll for hours on Twitter. We get just to the edge of the promised land. We take the bait of the fake news. We turn back and we look back to our own Egypt that we came from. And we forget of the land that God has promised for us. This good land. This land that flows with milk and honey. Instead, we make up for ourselves a similar story in life that devours us, consumes us, requires every waking moment from us. Friends, we cannot forget that this text that we are reading today is ours too. We are still the people of God. When we bite into the fake news that surrounds us, it steals us from the presence of God, and we too end up wandering like the Israelites. But I can assure you that there is hope not only for the Israelites, but for you as well. When we make it to Numbers 26, we find that second census that I was talking about. We find a new generation of Israelites that have been born into the wilderness. This new generation of Israelites did not come without a crossroad. As Reverend Abraham reminded us at the beginning of the Exodus story, liberation never comes without a cost. Justice and liberation are never free. This is something that we are reminded of as we enter into February. It's a journey that is long. It's a journey that requires the Israelites to be pruned into a generation that fears God and God alone. But when the journey is complete, the result is amazing. Again, it's a journey that takes time and patience, even for those of us who are reading along. In fact, you might not know, but we don't find out as a reader that the Israelites have made it into the promised land until the book of Joshua. Another book to get through before we can get to the promised land. But this new generation of God's heroes is who makes it there. To drive what is happening home once more, I want you to think of the book of John. If you know the book of John, you know that there are I am statements within it. In John 15, we actually find one of these great I am statements. And it says, I am the true vine, and my Father is the vine grower. God removes every branch in me that bears no fruit. Every branch that bears fruit, God prunes and makes it bear more fruit. It is an image that we can relate to this Israelite story, and it's a story that we can relate to ourselves today. God is pruning and shaping the Israelites into a people that no longer buy into the fake news, but buy into God's message of liberation from Egypt and promise of a land that flows with milk and honey. But the verse from John also tells us the same is true for us today. The price of liberation from the fake news that surrounds us sometimes requires that we truly have to listen to God. Imagine that. Tear down the false altars that we have set up for ourselves in our lives. It requires that in our wandering we allow God to remove from us the things that are dead, to remove from us our branches that are still pointing back to our Egypt. Our branches that are no longer bearing any fruit, the branches that have been steeped in the fake news for far too long. As Victor Ridge are called as a church to allow God to move and create for us a new generation in the wilderness, a generation that fears God and God alone. We are called to stop looking back from where we came from. Even when we are in the desert, we must remember the covenant and the promise that God has made for us, again, that promise that is leading us to a land that flows with milk and honey. Our pruning and wandering through the wilderness today might look something like this. It might look like whenever we're sitting there in the evening, we turn off the fake news that is on your TV, that does nothing but stir wrong emotions against yourself and against your neighbor. It might mean that we don't click on the bleeding articles that we see on our news feeds. It might mean that we set boundaries for ourselves that limit our ability to doom scroll the fake news that we see. It might mean that we stop scrolling through endless, perfect, 3-minute clips that lead us farther from the truth of who we are as children of God. It means that we acknowledge the dead branches that are still pointing back to our Egypt, whatever they might be for you, and we allow God to remove them from us. It means that we acknowledge the liberation that God is providing for us, and that it's never free, even when it comes to ourselves. It means that we trust in God at all costs, even whenever we're in the wilderness, when we look around and we see things that are bigger and stronger than us. When we see this land, may we remember that it's a land that flows with milk and honey and is rich with God's promises, rich with God's faithfulness, rich with God's love for you. Friends, we are all